Welcome to the Midday Talk with Nokoma, your host. This is a beautiful Monday. It's very warm outside. Yes, and today I have with me a walking testimony. I know that usually we have people, entrepreneurs on the show. People will tell us how they're making it in life. But today we are bringing a goodness of God. As the song said by Sisi Winans, "All my life you have been faithful." And on the stage, I have with me Mr. Juinor and his wife. He prefers to be called Mr. Juinor, correct?
Juinor.
Yes, yeah. And his wife. And they will tell us about the goodness of God. I know at times we hear of the stories and we wonder, is he still God, or are we just reading a God that we have heard in the Bible that he's doing miracles? But today, we are going to hear the story from a man who was resurrected by our Lord Jesus Christ. I'd like to welcome both of you to the show, and I believe that your story will change many lives. I believe that what you will tell us today will transform people, and you know, will bring us into a place where we understand that God has not changed. Please tell me.
Okay. In 2018, our whole life changed when my husband became ill. I think it was on a Wednesday morning.
Yeah.
On a Wednesday morning, he just had this terrible stomach ache that he was feeling. He was even sweating, the way the pain was so severe. And he's not a man that really complains. He came to me and he said, "Cheryl, please take me to the nearest hospital." So I immediately phoned my sons and asked them, Dexter and Blake, to please come take their dad to the nearest hospital because he's really not feeling well. They came. They took him to Green Acres, which was the nearest hospital. And then the doctor saw to him, and he sent him for an ultrasound, which they, when the ultrasound results came back, it was a bubble on his colon that burst, and immediately they had to admit him, of course. And then the surgeon that saw to him phoned the morning, the early morning hours of the morning, that was 12:30, to say that he's going to operate because something told him that he needed to do an urgent operation on my husband. Anyway, then myself and the two boys, sons, went down to Green Acres, and we were sitting in the waiting room, waiting for my husband to be wheeled out from the theater. Obviously, we couldn't go into the ICU at that time, but we saw him being wheeled in after the operation. Then the following day, in the morning, the doctor's secretary called to say that we need to come in, but I need to bring my family with me. And immediately I was thinking, wow. But anyway, I kept my peace because I know who I serve.
Oh, wow.
And I called Dexter, and Blake was at home, and I called my father-in-law, and my sister-in-law went to Earth as well, and we went down to Green Acres to see the surgeon. When we got there, the surgeon said to us that my husband is very, very ill, critically ill. And he explained to us what the problem was, the diagnosis, and he said to us that he's giving my husband 10% to live, and but with prayer, anything can change. And I looked at the doctor, but you know, I didn't take that report. I did not take that report. But I listened, but I thought to myself, I'm not taking that report because I know who I serve.
You know who you remind me of? You remind me of Isaiah when he said, you will believe the report of the Lord.
Yes.
You know, the doctor might have said something, but you knew whose report absolutely. You needed to believe.
Absolutely. But anyway, and then we left. I got home immediately. I called my prayer warriors. I belong to different groups. And that kept me going as well because my friends on the group used to, you know, continuously phone me or message me, and you know, and God kept me going. That is the that was the main one that kept me going, because I knew and I stood on His promises and I know His word, and I know with faith, and I believed, and I can have faith. And yeah, so every day we used to go visit, go check up on him, and my sons even, I think it was Dexter and Blackie, downloaded, you know, Christian music. We went to buy a little radio where we could put this, what do you call this?
Memory stick in.
And they used to set it up next to their dad's bed. He was in a coma at the time, and it was terrible to see my husband lying like that, knowing how he was so active, and, you know. But every day we used to go, and then my daughter came down. She took it a bit, you know, because she's daddy's girl. But the sons really, really stood by me, and of course my father-in-law, you know. And then I think it was 3 weeks after that, then I got a call from the ICU. The sister said the doctor asked me to come down, get my children together again, and come say our last goodbyes.
Aww.
Wow, that was like really terrible.
Yes, Master Collins, I would like to hear from you. I can see that you're emotional. I'm just thinking to myself, I am sitting here with a living testimony. I am sitting here with a miracle, you know, not just what we are reading, but I'm experiencing it myself. And I know this is emotional for you, but I would like you to tell us, because you are the one who felt all of these things. What was happening? What was going through your mind when this was happening to you?
Well, thanks for the opportunity. I didn't know what was going on.
Yeah, you was in a coma.
I was in a coma for 8 weeks. And but I remember after I was discharged from hospital, after 3 months, they were supposed to operate on me on the Thursday. Excuse me. I was admitted the Wednesday about noon. That I was scheduled for operation for a major op on the Thursday. But my surgeon is actually retired now, Dr. Tommy van Dijk. He told me, he said, Mr. Kannemeyer, I was at home. I actually got into bed. I was about to sleep. It was about 11 o'clock at night. He says, but you're on my mind. And he found the hospital and said, prepare that man for surgery. I'm coming in. If he didn't come in at that time, I would have died during the night. So I really believe that's God's hand.
Yes, man, absolutely.
Yeah.
Crazy. Yeah, so we continue. And then, 3 weeks down the line, then, like I said, the sister in ICU called me, because the doctor gave her instructions to call me and to get my family together, which I did. And we went down. And when I got there, they said my husband flatlined. But still, I had this peace of God.
Amen.
I had this peace of God.
Amen.
You know, because I know. And when I walked into the ICU and I saw my husband laying there, like not moving at all, because there was still no heartbeat, I couldn't stand seeing him like that. And I just turned around and I went to the corridor and I said, in that corridor. Mm. I said, Lord, I still need my husband.
Amen.
This and that, we made promises to each other. Mm. Lord, mm. I need my husband.
Mm.
And I stood on his promises, yeah. And I just prayed. And when I looked back, I saw my children still standing with standing and talking to the doctor. And then the two boys came out and they said to me, the doctor said to them that they need to look after me because, you know, sometimes when it's cases like that, then the spouse really takes trauma, you know. So I said to them, don't worry, I'm feeling fine. You know, I told them.
Mm, mm.
But anyway, then the next morning, I think Dexter called, or I'm not quite sure if the nurse or the sister called to say that my husband came around.
Wow.
That was a miracle.
A miracle.
That was a miracle, I'm telling you.
Can I just stop you? Mm. Now you were there, you're just walking, right?
Mm.
The doctor just gave you a report.
Yeah.
What came to your mind knowing that you might, now you are a widow,
mm.
and your children are fatherless? What came to your mind right there?
You know what? Mm. To tell you the truth, I haven't even given that a thought. That didn't even cross my mind. All I had was, I know my husband's going to come through this.
Yeah.
I did not have a thought of children being fatherless and me being a widow, because I told God, and you know, I don't know, that it was my faith.
Wow.
Honestly.
Indeed. Now I understand that the power of life and death is in our tongue.
Obviously.
And it's important for us to always speak life.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
There are times where we might be in situations where it seems like we are losing, but we do not have to change our confession.
Yes.
We know that He is a God who resurrects people.
Absolutely.
So, when you went to ask for prayers from your prayer groups,
yes,
was it specifically for him to come out of a coma or what?
Yes, yes, yes. I asked my prayer warriors to pray, help me pray, because I have the faith that my husband's going to be fine.
Amen.
And that is what they do.
Mm.
You know, they pray according to God's word and have faith with me.
Wow.
You see?
And I believe that this experience was not just, you know, emotional draining.
Oh, yes.
I'm reminded of the scripture where Jesus says in Luke, where there's a woman with the issue of blood,
yeah.
that she exhausted all her finances. Mm-hmm. Tell me about your finances. Were they in any way affected?
Ooh, terrible.
Mm.
We lost everything.
Mm.
We lost our home that was fully paid up, that my husband put all his hard work in, because he is a contractor. So he did all that, you know, extensions and beautiful things in the house.
Mm.
We lost all our cars we had. We lost everything.
Furniture as well.
For everything we lost.
Mm.
But I can tell you, sorry that I'm emotional.
It's okay.
I just thank God that my husband is alive.
Yeah,
I don't care about material things. I was a bit upset, I can tell you, because it's just normal, you know. But I'm so happy that my husband came through it. And I know God is alive. He did it. Nobody else.
I'm reminded that, you know, God cares about a human being. There is value in a life.
Yes.
You know, the life of a person is valuable more than the cars,
absolutely.
More than the house.
Yep.
Absolutely.
You lost all of that, but He is here.
Yes.
And
yes.
you are on your way of regaining all those. God is restoring. I believe
Hallelujah.
That now you have a house
Hallelujah.
As well.
Absolutely.
Hallelujah. You know, I agree with you there. I agree. This is our season.
Wow. And it's a beautiful testimony to our listeners. I believe that we need to know where to put value to.
Yes.
And
yes.
what to treasure most.
Yes.
Because
yes.
at times you can treasure these material things, but we forget to look at life.
Absolutely.
Life.
Yeah. Can I just add something in
yes,
there?
Yes, please.
Material things, I mean, you've got it today and you can lose it tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
Our focus must not be on material things.
Exactly.
There is no better gift than life.
Mm-hmm.
When you die, when you're dead, you're dead.
Mm.
There's nothing you can do.
Mm.
There's nothing. You can't provide for your family.
Mm.
In our case, having lost all our material things, but I'm alive.
Mm.
And all I'm looking for is opportunity so I can build myself up again, you know. Because I've just been lost for words. People mustn't focus too much on material things. Because these are things that you're going to have to leave behind one day anyway.
Yeah.
And, you know, talking about that, I'd just like to touch on one thing also while I was in ICU, while I was in a coma. I think my wife will be able to tell you more of that. When I had a bank of about 30 machines around me keeping me alive. And like in the movies, they were shutting down one by one until I was technically gone. And this doctor that came on duty at the time, I wasn't his patient. But I believe that it was God's divine intervention that he had to send that particular doctor in there. And he came in and he revived me.
Amen.
And you know, when they use those, I call it shockers, when they try to get your heart started, after X amount of times, if the patient's heart doesn't start, then you need to declare the patient dead. That guy broke every rule there was, and he carried on for 41 minutes and until my heart started again. And then they were afraid that I might have brain damage. Because if your body doesn't take in oxygen for at least 8 minutes, it affects your brain and you can actually be brain damaged. And I lost a lot of memory. When I eventually came by, I didn't know where I lived. I didn't recognize my house. I didn't recognize the vehicles. I didn't recognize anything. The only people I recognized was my wife, my kids. And I had to learn to walk again. I had to learn to talk because I lost my speech completely. But in that 41 minutes that I was technically dead, I was transported to another world.
Let's tell us more.
Okay. I was afforded the privilege to see hell. And I can tell you that hell is a real place. I've seen it. But when people ask me about it, my tongue gets tied. It's like I can't explain everything to them. Because I tell them, it's a privilege that was afforded to me. But I can tell you, there is a hell. I've seen it. And I believe that God saved my life for a reason. Yeah. He's preparing me for something big. I don't know, maybe she wants to carry
on. And maybe God, and maybe God has allowed him to see hell so that he can go out there and testify and tell people that hell is real.
Yeah, I wanted
that
to.
That is what, you know, that's my talk.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. I just wanted to find out, I mean, this experience, you know, has it in any way affected your relationship with the Lord? Has it grown to become stronger? I mean, are there things that you now know that you did not know then? Or are there things that you are doing now that then you did not know? But this experience, what did it do to you personally or to your faith?
It took a while to really sink in. Because after I was discharged and I was alone for, I don't know, maybe 6-7 months or so, I was going through a process of rehabilitation then, you know, learning to walk again and talk and things like that. But I spent a lot of quiet time on my own. And then I started reflecting on this time that I spent in the ICU. And I've always had a relationship with God. I think we all do have a relationship in our own ways, you know. Nobody's perfect angels.
Yeah.
I mean, I still smoke a cigarette. I still take occasional drink in that. but that doesn't make you a bad person. I believe that God prepares people to get his message across. to the other people.
Mm.
People that have some form of leadership.
Mm.
People that have some form of where other people will, what is the word, not recognize, but they will listen to you because they believe in you, you know. And I've spoken to several people, to quite a lot of people about my experience, you know, already. And they look at me in awe. Some probably think I'm crazy. But I'm telling you the truth. I was there. I've experienced it. I can tell people there is a hell.
Yes.
I've seen it. I've seen it. And it's a miserable place. It's a miserable place. I'll never forget one guy asked me once, so you saw the devil with a long tail? I said, no. It's nothing like that.
Mm.
It's a dark, horrible place.
Yeah.
A lot of screaming, just misery, misery, and wherever I went, the misery was never ending, I just went on, and it was crazy, but a privilege I believe it was afforded to me, that I can sit here and tell you that I have seen hell, and it is the truth, the God's truth, I've seen it. And I think this happened within that 41 minutes when the doctor was trying to revive me. Because remember, all my machines were off. There was no pulse, no heartbeat, absolutely nothing. And and while I was going through that journey, that out-of-body journey, the doctor carried on. And broke every rule and carried on. He didn't stop and say, I need to pronounce this man dead. Because I believe he needed to get my heart going again for me to come back. To give this message and say that I have been there and I'm back to tell the story.
So now you are telling a story of people need to be born again. People need to give their lives to Jesus.
Absolutely. In this last days, it's very, very crucial. And as my husband was saying, I believe that is God that took him out of a body experience to show him.
Yep.
And God brought him back.
Yes, for a reason.
For a reason. And the reason is to tell the world what he has seen.
Yeah.
Yeah, that there is hell and there is heaven. And I believe that, you know, I was just thinking, as you said, how the doctor broke every rule. I'm thinking of this song, Reckless Love, that he would leave the 99 just for the one. You know, I'm just thinking that Jesus had to come here on earth for us. You know, breaking everything that we think, you know, it's impossible for him to save humanity.
Yes.
You know, I left with 5 minutes. So before we round up the show, from both of you, I'd like to find out what is the message that you want us to have from your testimony? What do you want us to be left with from this testimony?
I'll let you look at first.
Okay. All I can say is when you're faced with challenges, don't run into a corner and sob and, you know, and go crazy. Put your trust in God. Pray about things. Have faith.
Yes.
Believe God's word. Because I believe the Bible is God. Go to God, go to the Bible and see what he says.
Yes.
You know? Because, I mean, in today's living, these last days, we need... I can't understand how people can't live with... How do they live without Jesus? They need Jesus, you know. There's so many things going around. And that is what I would love to leave with people, to and focus on this spirituality.
Thank
side.
You so much. And
my message will be that God is real.
Amen.
God is real.
Amen.
You know, today people are quick to pray when they need things, and they need it now. And when it doesn't happen, the first thing that goes out the window is their faith in God, you know. But the word tells us he does things in his time. You know, doesn't, because if it was so easy, if you just prayed for something and it's going to happen tomorrow, then everybody would just be doing the same thing.
Mm.
But going back to the experience that I've had with my encounter is that God is real.
Amen.
Because he's come through for me divinely. Mm. I mean, he's divine intervention from day one. Mm. You know, he's there. I am here. I'm sitting here talking to you only through his grace and through his mercy.
Amen.
It wasn't having the best surgeon, having the best medicine, having the best hospital, having the best of this. Because all of them said, you are going to die. I mean, on two occasions, they found my wife and kids. Early on, what you say, come say goodbye to your husband. Before the sun comes up, he will be no more.
Mm.
And here I am, almost 3 years later, giving the message. So my message to you is, to everybody out there, is God is real.
Hallelujah.
Thank you so much, Mr. and Mrs. Kannemeyer. It was lovely having you here. I mean, looking at you, your testimony, a living testimony. You know, at times most of us are asking ourselves, is this real? The God of resurrection, is it still? Can God still resurrect people?
Yeah.
And here you are today showing us that he is the same.
Yes.
He has not changed in any way.
Amen.
To our lovely listeners of Agape FM, this is the message that we have today. You know, a word of encouragement from the couple sitting right next to me saying that God is real. In whatever that you are going through, just have faith. Believe in God. Believe in the word of God. Believe what God is saying. And from me, signing out with Psalms 103, saying that, bless the Lord, O my soul. Forget not his benefits.
Mm-hmm.
And hold on to what God has said. Believe that even now, he can still do it for you as well. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you for having us.
Wonderful being here.
Thank you. And I hope that you will continue telling people the story. People need to be aware of the reality of the unseen world.
Yes,
thank you so much. We are signing out by Sister Wina saying, the goodness of God, enjoy. You are close like no one.